Let's welcome Travis.
Thanks, guys. Yeah, so thank you. So as he said, my name is Travis Tidwell. I'm the CTO and co-founder of Form.io. We will be talking about a lot about Form.io today. In fact, this is going to be a very hands-on session. We're going to be building an app from start to finish with Form.io. And you guys are going to see what it's like to actually build a web application within this platform. It does seem that we have a wide variety of people here. We have .NET, we have some full-stack JavaScript. We will be primarily focusing on front-end, and but also with Form.io, and this one thing that I'm going to really illustrate today is that Form.io really is a full-stack platform, and it's more than just forms. It's an entire API platform that you can build your entire application on top of, and I think that's really something that I want to illustrate today, that you can build a start-to-finish product using nothing but front-end technology sitting on top of the APIs generated from Form.io, and that includes user authentication, managing tokens, managing resources, APIs, nested resources. There's a lot of complexities that you can achieve with this platform, and that's really something that I want to do today, is really just illustrate how all that works. You can find me, I'm on Twitter, Software Gnome, but I'm also on GitHub. GitHub is really where I submit a lot of my code. I'm a very big advocate of open source. There you'll see a lot of open source projects. Form.io is also an open source project. So I'll be showing some of the core underlying front-end capabilities, the front-end form builder, the front-end form renderer. It's all AngularJS, ReactJS, but it's also open source. And it's something I encourage you guys to check out. So before we dive really deep into this, this presentation part of this session is going to be very short because we're going to be diving in immediately to build an actual real-life application. But I would like to just start off by talking a little bit about what Form.io is. It's a relatively new platform. It's been around for about a year and a half now. And the way that it works is it's built for this new concept called serverless applications. And the idea of serverless applications, it's kind of becoming this new trend nowadays, where in historical web development, a lot of developers would be used to building web apps, but doing so by doing renderings on the server. So the client would request a web page, and then you would maybe use PHP to render the page on the server and build that page using some backend scripting language. And then from there, you would then hand the client or hand the user an HTML page where they would then experience the website. This was a very backend heavy type of web. And the web is actually flipping right now, and that's actually a massive trend that's happening right now, where instead of these massive backend heavy web applications, we really almost kind of have an even split, where on the backend you have these very stateless REST APIs, and I make an emphasis on stateless because that becomes very important with the serverless applications. But then on the applications side, you also have entire applications that stand on their own two feet. Everything from the templates, the local databases, offline mode, these applications can be served and deployed anywhere. They do not need a server to be deployed. You can stick them on a phone. You can put them on a smart TV. You can compile them as a desktop application. You can put them on an S3 bucket. In fact, our entire website at Form.io, if you go to form.io, our entire website is being served from an S3 bucket. And we then hook that into a CDN. So what you're actually experiencing is an application that is completely isolated from the backend server and only talks to the server via this thing called REST APIs. So this diagram here is used to illustrate that. So on the front end, you have this form. And a lot of times whenever people are building web applications, a lot of the I/O, the data manipulation or the data input is done through the use of a form. So if you think about it, it all kind of starts with a form. And whenever the user inputs data, that's kind of where the data manifests itself. From that point, it then can only talk to the backend server via REST API. So this form is really isolated. It's not rendered on the server. I previously gave a talk. Some of you guys may have been to that. It was called JSON Powered Forms. And the whole idea behind JSON Powered Forms is that you're isolating these forms from the server and they're rendering dynamically on the front end. So these are forms that render themselves within the application using a REST API JSON call. And then they only talk to the server via REST API. So that kind of gives you the gist of what Form.io is. It's a very different platform, but it's also way more than forms. And that's something that I really want to highlight, is that it's also an API platform. And we're going to be building an app using nothing but Angular and Form.io in this talk. This link down here at the bottom, that is a GitHub URL that I'd like all of you guys to go to. This is our open source Form.io core. From there, that kind of branches out to a number of open source libraries, which includes a front-end renderer, a form builder, a data grid component that allows you to view your data, all REST API driven. But this repo right here is kind of our flagship repo. Please go to that repo, star it. It means a lot to us whenever we get more followers onto that repo. It is open source. So let's talk a little bit about what serverless applications means. And I did kind of touch on this a little bit, but there's a few other things, a few other aspects about serverless that's important to grasp. One is that, and as I mentioned before, the architectures are completely separate. The app exists on its own and can only talk to the backend via REST APIs. There's also another really big, massive movement happening right now, which is this thing called microservices. Some of you guys have heard of AWS Lambda. This is a microservices platform where you can write these functions and then you execute those functions and you pay for the amount of CPUs that function took. And it's this almost like this micro service architecture. And so these apps can leverage those to exist and serve. And you can call functions on a remote server. And it feels like you're calling those functions within the app, but it's actually making calls remotely. Another thing is that it leverages stateless REST APIs. And stateless REST APIs is really the where Form.io focuses itself. And stateless is important here. What does stateless mean? A lot of people hear stateless. Okay, what does it mean to have a stateless REST API? Does that mean that your app cannot have states? Absolutely not. In fact, stateless has nothing really to do with the app. It has more to do with the backend REST API. And what it really means is that the server is no longer responsible for the state of the app. That's the app's responsibility. So to give you a really good example, I come from Drupal. And in Drupal, you would log in to Drupal, and you would log in, and that would create a cookie on your browser, and that cookie would give you a session ID, and every request I made to Drupal would include this session ID. Well, what would Drupal then do at that point? It would take that session ID, look up in the database, find the user object, and at that point, that person has a state that has been stored on the server. Stateless REST APIs eliminates that. And it does so through the use of tokens. This, in fact, Form.io uses this thing called a JWT token, where instead of the server using, like let's say Redis to store sessions, we actually hand every single user their state via a token. And it's digitally signed, so they can't muck with it. They can read it, but they can't change it. Otherwise, the digital signature is invalid, and we know they've changed it. And so that's actually a really good way to scale. You can scale your web services using tokens and stateless REST APIs. Form.io is a stateless REST API platform, and I really want you that to be a good takeaway here, is because you can build an entire REST API using it. So I've given previous talks about JSON-powered forms, about APIs, about Form.io, and I've gotten really philosophical, let me put it that way. I'm not going to do that in this session because I've already done that. And I've already got some videos out there that you guys can watch. This is a video that I encourage you guys to watch if you have some time. It's about 20 minutes. And this is really kind of the philosophy behind Form.io. When I talk about JSON-powered forms and what this new movement means. When you have time, go check that out. In the meantime, I'm going to be spending my time today on actually experiencing what it's like to build an app in Form.io and what it's like to build an app using entirely REST APIs, where it's entirely stateless. The app is not stateless. the backend API server is. So let's dive right in and let's actually build something with Form.io.
Question, how do you get onto the server?
On the server.
I mean, do we have
Wi-Fi?
Oh, there's a Wi-Fi.
On the Wi-Fi. Oh, okay. The Wi-Fi is...
It's framed.
I'm sorry?
Yes.
Yeah, it's right here. It's going to be matrix guest, and the key is capital M matrix, capital R, res, R-E-S, and then 1,000. Cool. All right, so let's get started. So what are we going to be building today? Today we're actually going to be building a movie manager application. And this app is going to include user login. It's going to be to where you can build playlists. And inside that playlist, you'll be able to add YouTube movies to your playlist in a grid format. I'll be able to click on those movies, watch those movies. So essentially we're going to be building a movie manager application. And I know what you're thinking, there's no way we're going to be able to do that in 1 hour. And that's really the power that I'm going to show you with Form.io, is we are going to be able to do that in 1 hour. We're going to have user logins, we're going to have playlist management, as well as a grid view of movies, and you're going to be able to view the movies. It's a really cool application. And with Form.io, we can actually bootstrap this application. And so let's say you guys just don't want to go through the work of actually running this app. There is a command, and I might show this to you at the end, that you can actually type Form.io bootstrap. And because this application already exists on GitHub, I'm going to show you the source code here in a minute. What it does is there's a special file in that GitHub repo called a project.json file. And that actually builds the API platform for you in the back end. It clones the app and connects it to that API platform. So with one single command, you've essentially not only cloned the back end, but you also have cloned the front end as well, so you can make it your own. So that's also some really cool stuff you can do with this serverless applications. So let's get right started. So the very first thing that you're going to want to do you're going to want to log in to Form.io. And actually, I don't even have a browser up, so let me actually open up a new browser. Do full screen here, and we're just going to go to form.io. And typically you're going to start with Form.io, because Form.io is going to be the place where you go and set up all of your resources. It's going to be the place where you get that API platform started. When you first start an account, this is actually the first page you see. So we have these tutorials, we have, you know, walkthrough user guides. As you can see, I've already kind of been playing around with one of these applications. This application, this existing project that you see here, this was actually created by me clicking on this service tracker. And what this does, any of these existing templates, what they do is they build your entire API platform for you, including all the resources, the user logins, everything, all the forms that you need to have a working application. So before we dive into building our own, let me just kind of just very briefly show you kind of what this application looks like. So here we have resources. These are all the database objects that you can create. So in this application, we have customers, we have contractors. Contractors are assigned appointments that they need to go to the customers to service their equipment. And all of these things are forms. So whenever you're building, and I'm going to be going through all of this, whenever you're building a resource in Form.io, all you're doing is building a form. So if you guys can build a form, you guys can build your own REST API. And that's actually kind of the point behind Form.io. You're taking a form builder, and through the use of a form builder, you are actually building a REST API, but you just don't even know it. And the reason is because when you build a form, you are dragging and dropping fields onto that form, and you're defining essentially a schema. And that schema can be used to generate the REST API to support it. Excuse me. So very briefly, let's just take a look what this application comes with. Every single app has a preview. I can log out, and I can launch this into a new window. So here's an application. It has a user login. I can just log in right here. And once I log in, I can actually go and create some dealers. Here's a dealer that I've already created. Once I create a dealer, I can go create some customers. Here's a customer. I'm filling in data. So this right here has an address, and with the address, I get GPS coordinates. I can go and create equipment. There's a form that you just saw. And so basically through the use of forms and data inputs, I'm actually able to create like this nested resource relationship. So I can go create a contractor. There's the contractor form. So essentially what I have here is a serverless application that kind of stands on its own and only uses the APIs generated by Form.io to really do everything that it does, including authentication and including data management. So let's actually start from scratch. Let's build our movie manager application. The very first thing that I like for people to do is I actually like for people to start with the default template. This actually provides you very basic user auth, which how many of you guys have been to an entire session where all you learn how to do is log in? I mean, there's some complexities there, but all you have to do is click on this default tab, and that actually created an application that we can actually use to build our movie manager application. So let's take a look at some of the resources that we have here. Right away, we just have two resources, one called user, one called admin. And I know what you're probably thinking right now. Aren't users admins? I mean, like, why don't you have just a single user table? With Form.io, the way that we built our platform is you can have buckets of data. And with the way our authentication works, you can authenticate against any one of those buckets. So you can have a resource called admins, and you can set up your login action to log into either users or admins. And people are assigned roles based on what they log into. So let's talk a little bit about user authentication, roles and permissions. So that's actually lesson number one that's really important to understand when you're building an app in Form.io. So right here we see two resources, one called user, one called admin. There's also this thing called roles. So if I click on project settings and I go over to the roles section, you'll see that I start off with two roles immediately. One which is administrator, one is anonymous, and one that is authenticated. I can create my own roles if I wanted to. So in the case of that service tracker application that you guys just saw, there's a dealer role. And dealers have certain permissions. There's a contractor role. Contractors have different permissions than the dealer. So anytime that you need to segregate permissions, that would be a good case to create a role. How are you assigned a role? Let's talk about that. To be assigned a role is done through the actions of that resource. So here we have a user resource. If I click on that, you see a form builder. So let's say I wanted to create full name. In fact, I am going to add full name here because I want my users to give me their full name. I quite literally drag and drop a text field onto the form, call it full name, and then I hit save resource and I'm done. I just added a field to my API as well. I didn't have to like edit the backend. I didn't have to edit a configuration. I just dragged and dropped a field on the form, click save, and now if I click on info, you'll see full name is right there and it's ready to go. I can submit full name to this API and it will happily accept it. You can also provide validation criteria. So all of the validation that you would normally want to do, so like let's say required, do you want it to be unique, minimum, maximum length, regular expression, it has to match that, let's say even custom validation. All of these things you can actually write in one single place, but they're executed in both places, not only on the front end, but also on the back end. So because these are serverless apps, you kind of have to think double. In fact, developers have to think double these days. They don't anymore. Form.io takes care of it. Both of those validations occur on both the front and back end at the same time. So let's talk about how is a user assigned a role. Every single time I submit this form, I end up executing the actions associated with that resource. And actions are quite literally just stackable middleware. So if any of you guys are familiar with Node, you're going to be familiar with this concept of middleware. Form.io is built on top of Node.js, and we've highly leveraged that concept through this use of actions within the forms. So the very first action you see here is it's going to save the submission. The second thing you see here is it's going to assign a role. So whenever I submit and add a new user to this resource, these actions will sequentially execute themselves. And so that new user role will actually get assigned the authenticated role. So now I know that if I add a new user to the user resource, they're going to have that role. If I take a look at admin, you'll notice it looks very similar. The only difference is the role assignment is giving them the role of administrator. Once a user is assigned a role, how do you decide what they have access to? So authentication is all about assigning roles, assigning what that role has permission to, and then the last but not least, authenticating into that role. So the access tells you what role has access to what thing. Every single resource you create, you can decide what permissions that person should have within that resource. It's very straightforward. And we're doing all of this within a UI. So now the very last thing about user authentication that you need to know about is how do you authenticate into that role? So whenever I log in, so a login would be a form. And so to create that form, I quite literally go to my existing resource fields and I drag this email field onto this form, which I've already done that, and then this password field on there as well. And then login has a very special action. You'll notice you don't see safe submission. The reason why you don't see safe submission is because when you log in, you're not saving anything. What you're doing is you're authenticating. So I submit this form, and what I'm doing is I'm saying, what resources do you want to authenticate against? So now I'm saying authenticate against user and admin. And what that means is if I have an admin record and I type in the email for that admin in the login form, it's going to go look up that admin, find them, and authenticate against them. Let's create two new resources. We're going to have to move quickly. Does everyone have any questions about authentication? We're good. We're going to move quickly here because I'm going to very quickly build the REST API to support our Movie Manager application. Okay? And I'm going to do it in about 5 minutes. So the very first thing that we're going to do is we're going to build a playlist where you're going to create playlists. So I'm going to say playlist. I'm going to give it the API path of playlist. Your playlist may have two fields in it. Maybe the title of the playlist, and then it may have like a text area, which is the description. And I'm going to hit save. Congratulations, we're done with our playlist. So it really is that easy. The one other thing that we have to do is in our access, we have to tell it that I want authenticated people to create their own playlists. If you're authenticated, you should be able to create your own. So create own submissions. I'm going to add authenticated to create own, read own, update own, and delete own. I also have another requirement of my application. I want authenticated people to be able to see other authenticated people's playlists. I want this to be a community of playlists. There's one more I need to add, which is read all submissions. I want authenticated people to read all these submissions. So it doesn't matter if it's theirs, if it's somebody else's, they can still read it. So immediately, I think you guys can see how you can kind of lock down things based on their role. You can kind of really refine what they have access to. And I'm gonna hit save submission. We are done with playlists. Let's move on to movies. The movie, I'm just gonna say movie. And what do we want for movie? We want title. I also want another text field because I want them to use YouTube to provide the YouTube ID, which is going to be the movie. So I'm going to say, hey, just input the YouTube ID, and that's going to be your movie. And I want to basically leverage a already amazing video platforms, and they just need to provide the YouTube ID. So I'm going to say another text field.
It could be video ID?
Could be. Well, in the app, yes, it can be. In the app, you would need to have some NGS to say if they provided YouTube, render it this way. If they provided Vimeo, render it this way. I'll show you how to do that, but yes, you can. For now, that's pretty much going to be it. There's one other thing. Movies are inside a playlist. So a playlist should be able to have many movies, okay? So now we're talking about nesting relations, creating a relationship of one-to-many relationships where movies need to be within a playlist. And the way you do that in Form.io is actually very easy. That's also another component. Thinking yourself, if I were to see a form on how to create a movie where I assign it a playlist, what would that form look like? Well, the form would, you'd provide your title, you would also see a YouTube ID, and then you might see a select dropdown that says select what playlist this movie belongs to. And we actually have a special component called resource. And this resource field allows you to relate or link this to have essentially a parent resource. And I'm going to say playlist on that. I'm going to hit save. I highly encourage you guys. I don't have time to go through all of these other components. We have a whole slew of amazing components. We have data grids, surveys. We have signature component. You can do e-signatures. You have WYSIWYG editors. I mean, all kinds of cool stuff that you guys can add to your apps this way. So once we're done with that, I'm going to hit create resource. And guess what? My movie is done. I have one more thing I need to do, which is I also need to do the same permissions on the movies as well. They need to be able to create their own. They need to be able to read their own. They need to be able to update their own, as well as delete their own. And I also want them to read all of them. Okay? Does everyone kind of because I know that's kind of a hard concept. Does everyone kind of get why I'm doing that?
If you wanted to put an image on that movie, you create a field for that?
Well, I'm going to show you the app we're going to build is going to be able to pull in the thumbnail from YouTube.
So you don't have to have a field for thumbnail.
There's two ways to do images. One, you could have the URL, copy and paste the URL, or
but you already have the
we also have a file ID. Component.
You already have the UID.
I already have the ID, so I'm going to be able to pull the thumbnail from the ID. I'm going to show that. I'm going to actually show that in this app. We also have file uploads. And our file uploads is actually amazing. It does not upload the file to our servers. The way our file uploads work is it's a direct upload to an S3 bucket from the browser. So the browser is actually doing the uploading to Amazon S3 directly. That gives us some, that returns some metadata, and that metadata is what's submitted to the form. It's a way, way more scalable way to do files in an app. Excuse me, I've had like some frogs in my throat today.
Good question. So on your roles and rights, the example, if I get it, is here where individual controls their own stuff but can view others. So is there a concept of like intermediary organizations where somebody can be a member of an organization, they have their own rights, organizational rights, but then maybe segmented tenant rights where they can't see somebody else's?
So you're talking about group-based permissions? We don't quite have group-based permissions, but what we do have is permissions based on association. So like right here, I'm assigning a playlist. Let's say I only want to give permissions based on that association.
Okay.
The greatest use case that we have here is that the app that I showed you before, you have dealers. And dealers have customers.
Yeah.
But dealers do not want other dealers to see their customers. So only they, and then they have contractors, and their contractors should be able to see the customers, but not this dealer's contractors. So through association, you can establish permissions,
okay.
And you do that through this, submission resource access. This actually gives you delegated access based on association.
Okay.
So it's much more advanced. Group-based permissions is actually something different, and we are working on that type of permission as well.
Okay.
Really good question.
Thanks.
So now that we're done with our movie resource, it's time for us to actually move on to the app. We are done with our API platform. So in a matter of no time at all, you can click on the API tab, I've essentially just generated this entire API. As you can see here. And normally when you're building an app, this would take a while. Like you would be spinning your wheels building all of this. But with Form.io, you're getting all of this CRUD capability, you're getting indexes, you're getting all of these by simply building a form. And you're getting all of that. Let's actually move to launch the application. We're going to launch the application. You can actually see a preview of what we're going to start off with, which is the basic default app, which looks like this. we're going to clone this and fork this to our local server, and we're going to just start hacking it and start making this a movie builder. I highly recommend people start off by clicking on the launch tab and clicking on local app development, because that's kind of the documented workflow that we're going to follow. Okay, I'm not going to be reading this, but this is the documented workflow that we're going to go through to essentially make this app come alive. So as you see here, this app is actually connected with a GitHub repo. And let's actually go to that GitHub repo real quick. So I'm going to go to github.com for my app, and it's basic. This is a starter application that'll allow you to really quickly get started. And you can go and fork and download this. And then once you fork and download it, you're pretty much to the point where I am right now. The first thing that you're going to want to type is npm install. I've already done that previously because I don't want to take down the network. If all of you did this right now, it would probably take down our network. So don't do that. Do it when you get home. One other gotcha, and this is really annoying, and I want to make sure that I talk about this because you're going to run into this most definitely, is what you see right here. This is actually not a problem with Form.io. This is a problem with the BootSwatch theme. And the way you solve this, it cannot find that branch, is you actually uninstall it, --save, BootSwatch, and then you reinstall it. Bower install, --save, BootSwatch. And for some reason, that gets it out of that little funky state right there, where it actually finds the branch now, and it finds the same branch. It's the weirdest thing in the world. So here we're actually going to do an install. I'm going to just make sure that everything's installed, and we're good to go. I could actually type at this point gulp serve and have a running application. The thing is, the very first thing that you have to do is you have to configure it to point to the API that we just generated. That's the very first step. So you're going to go over to your source code, and you're going to open up this very special file called config.js. And in config.js, you're going to see this app URL, and it's going to point to, it says your app. Really, all you need to do is replace that subdomain with the subdomain that you just created. So I'm going to go over to my app that I just created. It's right here. And this actually even gives us our subdomain. It's right there. We dynamically alter that in the app. So I'm going to copy that. I'm going to paste it right there. And now, whenever I type gulp serve in my application, this is going to open up a brand new application. Let me make sure I log out here. Oh, dang it, I've got something that's overlapping it. Where did it go? I think it just... My little fork me on GitHub is... hang on. We probably should move that. Hang on, let me just delete you. Yay. Okay. So, what you actually see at that point is a working application where I've got my login and my register. Let's talk about register. Didn't I just add full name? I added full name to the user. I want to see that in my registration. Why did I not see that? Well, the reason is because registration form is different from the resource. So the resource is here, and the form for registration is here. And all we have to do is go here, existing resource fields, and drag our full name onto that form and hit save. The very last thing we have to do, and this will actually talk a little bit about how our safe submissions work. So registration has safe submission. Login did not, if you remember. The reason why registration has a submission is because it's actually saving the user, then it's logging them in. But it's not saving them to this specific form. It's saving the submission to the user resource. So when I click on save submission, you'll notice that there's this configuration that says save submission to user. And from there, I have field mappings. So now I just need to make sure I map the full name field in this form to the full name field in the user form. And now we've got essentially a mapped user. So whenever I register, I'm going to have that user be created. Let's actually try it. So now, what's also another great thing about Form.io is whenever I deploy an app, let's say this app was already deployed in a million people's hands, and I have to add a field, one single field to one form. Historically, what would you have to do at that point? You'd have to add the form to the app, and you'd have to go into the app store and redeploy your app just to get that one field to the application. With Form.io, because these are dynamically rendered forms, the next time that somebody loads the form, that field immediately shows up. Because it's dynamic, it's a single embed code. In fact, what's adding that form right here, in fact, you can see the documentation right here, is one single line of code. It's one directive that points to that user login form. It works like an image tag. If you can embed an image into your application, you can now embed a full working form. And that includes all the I/O behind it and everything. So let's create a user.
Sorry, did you mention App Store a moment ago?
Yeah.
With these? So does that kind of approach actually pass muster through their like iOS acceptance process?
From what I mean, we have apps right now and it's AngularJS. They're letting AngularJS apps that have dynamically generated content today.
Huh.
All this is just a dynamically generated form content.
Thanks.
So I'm gonna go create a user in this app, and I'm gonna submit, and that's gonna log me in. I'm now logged in. So once I'm logged in, I really kinda wanna change this up a little bit. I want to, in fact, I'm just gonna get out of full screen mode here. Maybe I might be able to figure out how to get my log out right there. There we go. I just have to resize it to log out. So now at this point, we're going to start making changes. We're going to turn this into a movie management application, because what I want to do is I want to make it so the first thing you see is playlists. I apologize. I'm at 7:30 right now. From this point on, I am going to be moving fast. But I'm recording this, so you guys are going to be able to watch this over again. Okay. First thing in firmware is almost every time I start a new app, I want to change the theme. I want it to look different. Form.io, for all the applications that we have out there, we have a number of apps. All of them are boot swatch compatible. That was the thing that we had to reinstall at the beginning. But what is boot swatch? So boot swatch, if you guys go to bootswatch.com, it's awesome. You can make your website have any different theme. So there's Cerulean, here's Cosmo, this makes it look like Metro. They even have one, if any of you guys use Material UI, they have one called Paper that looks like Material UI. It's awesome. If you guys want like a cyborg, like dark, start off with a dark theme, we can do that as well. I always do this. I start off with a theme that's close to what I want. And then I just modify just gradually tweak the colors to make it exactly what I want. The one we're going to use is called Cosmo. I like that one a lot. It looks really good. The forms look really good in Cosmo. So how do you do that? So inside of your WebStorm, the very first thing we're going to look at, in fact, because we're using the basic application, I've already got all of this thing like set up for you. You're going to click on this app folder inside of this index.scss. That's a SAS file. We're going to open that up. And you'll see that I've commented out two lines here. And I've commented out these two lines just so to let you know, here's how you pull in BootSwatch. So to pull in BootSwatch, you're gonna uncomment those lines. You're gonna uncomment this line. And now we're ready for BootSwatch. And now you see these two are the two variables that you would need to change if I wanted to use a different theme. Because I'm using Cosmo, all I have to do is keep that as Cosmo. And now if I refresh my page, you'll notice my theme is awesome. It looks different. And so, I mean, all the buttons look different and it's like blue, looks really cool. You can also tweak the colors here. So this is like SAS. So right after variables, I can actually define, you know, like what is it, primary color. I don't know what it is exactly. You'll have to read the documentation, but I can actually change the colors here. So this is how you would tweak it. And just tweak the colors ever so gradually, and then that'll actually modify throughout the entire CSS those colors, and then you're able to kind of highly refine what you want your theme to look like. The next thing I'd like to do is I'd like to bring in the resources that I just created. I created playlist and I created movie. The very first thing that I always do is I then bring those resources into the application. And that's actually surprisingly a lot easier than you think it is as well, because we have a lot of helpers that help you build these applications. So going back over to WebStorm, we're going to go back to our config.js file. And inside config.js file, you'll see that there's this thing called resources. And already we see user. We're just going to add two more entries here, one for the playlist and one for the movie. So I'm going to type playlist, app URL. The URL I gave it was playlist. If you guys remember, whenever I built the form, I made the API URL playlist. And then I'm going to define a resource called playlist resource. And then I'm going to create a movie one. The form is app URL movie. And the resource is movie resource. There's only one other thing that I have to do to bring in my resources, which is just copy the existing user resource, the resource object. That's a JavaScript object, and those are defined in app resources folder. So if I go to my resources folder, I'm going to copy the user, and I'm going to paste it. I'm going to create one called playlist, and I'm going to create another one called movie. Let's open a playlist first of all, because I just have to rename this playlist, and then I just have to rename this movie. What did that just do? Because that just did something that's amazing. Okay? If I refreshed my application, you're not going to really notice anything, but you would if you knew all the URLs to go to. The first one is the name of the resource, create. So if I type playlist in capital create, what is it? I might have to refresh. Oh, you know what? It's a new config file, so I'm going to have to do a gulp serve again, I bet. I hope that's what it is. Type playlist. Okay, so movie, what is... Oh, it's create... Oh, okay. Ha. What it is create / playlist. We now have the ability to create a playlist. Let's create a new playlist. This is going to be Summer Movies 2016. And I'm going to hit submit. You notice I don't have to do anything. It just does things for me. Like I didn't write the connections to the API. It just did it. So here I've got my playlist. I can edit it. I can delete it. Let's say, how do I view the playlist? You'll see that if I just go to playlist URL, I'll see the index of playlists. Let's create another one. Comedy movies.
Is there a NoSQL behind the scenes?
Is there what?
The database, NoSQL?
The database is Mongo.
Mongo.
So now we have two movies. Now, one thing that you'll probably also notice is that I'm not nesting anything right now.
Wait, I thought you said those were playlists.
Well, they are. This is the default index view. And so these are playlists that I'm looking at right now, that I'm creating. What I can now do is go to movie. So if I type movie, you'll see here are my movies. I could say create a new movie, and I could select a playlist. Now you'll notice this, oh, why does that dropdown look weird? Well, that dropdown looks weird because inside my movie resource, I can go click on edit inside playlist. There's this thing called item template. If I make that point to the title field of the movie and hit save, go back to my app, hit refresh, those would now look good. Let's say you want a many-to-many relationship. Let's say like something complicated, like children have many parents. In a normal REST API, or you're building an app that does that, it's hard. But with Form.io, because it's all a form driven, I can quite literally just say allow multiple resources, click save, hit save submission. I now have many to many relationship, where now instead of selecting one, I can select as many as I want.
Very nice.
Thanks.
Yeah.
So there's one other thing that I need to do, which is now inside create movie, I'm not really creating this inside a playlist. I could assign this to a playlist, but what I would rather do is I would rather create a playlist and inside of the playlist create the movie, and it just automatically knows to assign it to that playlist. And to do that, you actually create the nesting that I was referring to earlier, where inside of the provider, you'll notice inside the movie provider, we have this thing called parent. Parent is basically the field in that form that defines its parent. So what was the name of the field? The name of the field was parent, I believe. The way you look at that is you click on the field. Under API, it's called playlist. You can quite literally copy that, move over here, and paste. And the very last thing you need to do is under the base is the URL that you want to use as the base for the movie paths. So I want my base, to the UI router base, to start at playlist period, because I want to say playlist create movie to create a new movie. So playlist period is the base, and when I do that, you'll notice the behavior changes a little bit. So right away, I'm going to say playlist. There's my indexes. I'm going to click on that playlist. Now, if I were to say create movie, I can create a new movie in this playlist. And do you guys see what just happened here? Where did the playlist field go? The playlist field is there. It's just auto-populated and hidden. It knows it's already in the context of the playlist. It already knows what its parent is. So it fills it out for you and hides it. So that way, whenever I create this, I'm gonna have to have YouTube up here. Summer trailers 2016. Let's see, movie trailers. So like, let's say movie trailers. I think there's actually a playlist. Let me do movie. Where's the one that I like to use? This one right here, I like this one. So I can actually go Captain America, Civil War, I'm gonna just create a, this is inside my playlist, I'm gonna say that, and I'm gonna give it the ID. There's the ID of that, and when I hit submit, I think that should be auto-pop. Yeah, it is, it's just the, yeah, it just, it was there, it's just like the, I got my CSS modification I need to make. Because it's there, so it actually did make the association within that playlist. What just happened? So now let's talk a little bit about making this look the way I want it to. Okay. So now I've got my app working. I'm able to create movies inside playlists. Let's talk a little bit about changing this home page to where that should go to playlist index. In fact, when people log in, I'm gonna have to resize it to log in. When people log in, I want them to go, so I can actually use the login that I just did. I want to go right to the playlist. So if we take a look at our app here, inside the app.js, you'll notice that there's a config, and inside the config, we're actually providing some helpers here. So immediately what's going on is actually about 10 lines of code. Everything that's working so far is really just 10 lines of code. And all we really need to modify, and I think you can already see it, is this home state. Right now, this set states, this tells the auth provider, which is a helper that you use to tell it how the authentication should behave. I'm gonna tell it when it logs in, I wanna go to playlist index. I don't wanna go to home. And so all I do is I'm going to change this home to playlist index, and then I'm also going to change this otherwise go to playlist. So now let's talk a little bit about these states. Now, a lot of people, whenever they see this, they think this is like something magical is going on here. Like, what is going on? Like, how is 10 lines of code creating all of this business logic? This is where I really like to talk about, it's very important right now to read the comments in these resources. That's one thing. We wrote a lot of really good comments in this resource file that kind of tells you all of these configurations. But this resource object is handed to a very special provider called the Form.io resource provider. And you'll see where it's handed off right here. It's registered under name, or this register name. And then I'm basically injecting that object into the resource provider. I highly recommend to go and just look at that helper. And that's under Bower Components, ng-formio helper, and go look at the source code in ng-formio-helper. And what we're going to look at is this Formio resource register function. One thing you're going to see here is something that will probably look familiar if you're into AngularJS, which is UI router states being registered all over the place. We have create, read, update. Here's the abstract for the create, read, edit, delete. There's the view, there's edit, there's delete. So really what that's doing is just registering a lot of states for you. It also gives you a lot of control over what those states are doing. So you can define your own controllers that'll actually get instantiated. So whenever I said playlist index, the reason why I knew how to do that is because I passed in playlist here, and this is registering a UI router state called playlist index, and that is the grid view. I don't have enough time to dive deep into this file, but I recommend you guys looking at the source code. It's, there's a lot going on there. So once I actually do that, let me actually log out and log back in. Let me refresh. And now I'm in the index. So it's immediately, now I've logged into the index and I can see my summer movies. The next thing that I really would like to do is I'd like to change my playlist view so that instead I see this, I want to see a grid view of all of those images. And to do that, we're going to have to override a template. And really, what I'd like to see is I'd like to see movie. Oh, this is also something interesting. Because I did nested resources, if you go to movie underneath playlist, this will show you a filtered list of movies for that playlist. Like even the index filters for you. So that if I added a new movie here, but then I added a movie in the other playlist, they're not going to conflict with each other. This will only have the movies in this playlist. But what I'd really like to do is make my playlist view, I want it to be this. So like anytime I click on view, why is it doing that? anytime I click on view, oh, I think I know why. It's because I got other. So when you're running a gulp serve, it does a WebSocket connection to your browser, and if you have other browsers up, it can kind of mess things up. So let's actually create a grid view of movies, and then I think we'll be done. And then we'll essentially have a movie manager, and then I'll show you guys how you can create a YouTube video as well. So first and foremost, I want to, instead of clicking on, when I click on view, I don't want to go to this page, I want to go to the movie page. And so to do that, I am actually going to go to the playlist provider here, and I'm going to change some of these configurations. The very first one that I'm going to change is this thing called the abstract. The abstract is what I see here, the view, edit, delete. This is like a wrapper around an actual playlist object. It's called the abstract. And if I override the template there, I can actually modify what that view, the state that view tab is going to go to. So to do that, so right here I'm in templates, I want to override the abstract. Let's talk about how to do that. You're going to go up to the ng-formio helper, you're going to look in templates, you're going to look at a resource, and you'll see that there's this one called resource HTML. I'm going to copy that, and I'm going to come over to my resources, I'm going to create a folder, I'm going to call that playlist. Inside there, I'm going to drag and drop that playlist. And you know what? I'm also going to drag this playlist up in there as well, just because I like everything to be organized. And I know you're probably like, well, don't you have to change where that JS file is being referred to? We're using this thing called Gulp. Using Gulp. That's what you're seeing right here. It actually figures out where scripts are, and it automatically injects them where they need to. So you don't even have to mess with that, just move it. Inside that resource file, I now need to tell my provider the new path to that So I'm going to say app resources playlist resource.html. And then if I went in here, I could actually do something. So let's say, first and foremost, what I want to do is instead of the resource name, I like right now you see it say playlist. I want that to say the movie name, first and foremost. So I can do that first and foremost. So like I can say current resource. Okay, where is that coming from? Well, that's I get on that question a lot. Like, where are these variables being defined? That's why it's really important to look inside of the ng-formio helper. And if you take a look at the abstract state, it's creating this thing already on the scope called the current resource. And it's also passing, so it's actually loading the form and it's assigning that to the form, but then it's also loading the submission and it's assigning the submission to current resource submission. So by defining the form and defining that path to the API, I can essentially, this helper is actually loading that playlist object for me and assigning it to current resource. It's also assigning it to another special variable called the name of the name that I pass in. So this would be like scope playlist. Or actually it's up here. Where am I assigning it? Right here. So I'm saying scope playlist is equal to. So I could actually say playlist resource, and that'll actually point to the data object of the playlist in my template. So if I said, I could do say current resource, but I typically like to use the actual name. So if I say data, playlist data, title, I can get rid of this, and hit refresh on that. That should. Maybe it's current. Oh, I know what I did. You're right. Yeah, whoever said that, you're right. Awesome. Playlist resource data title. There it is. And now what I'd like to do is awesome. Now what I'd like to do is change. Instead of going to view, I want to go to movie index. And this will now, and also this is active. I need to change that as well. Movie index. That'll do my. So now if I click on that, I now see view. And there we go. Edit view. Awesome. Now what I want to do. Oh, actually, what is. Yeah, so that's actually showing the movie index. What I want to do is now change that into a grid of movies. I'm going to change the index view of the movie. So inside movie, I got to move quick. Sorry, guys. I'm going to create a folder called movie. Drag this in there real quick. I'm going to go copy the index. I'm going to paste it. And I'm going to get rid of this grid view for now. And instead, I'm going to replace it with just like, just so that I know that I did it. And then in here, I'm going to change the path to app resources movie index.html. And so now what that should do is there's my high. So what I want to do is I want to create a grid view of movies here. Forgive me, I am going to copy and paste on this next section just because we're running out of time and I want to make sure I get through all of this. If you go to Formio app movie, you're going to have the entire application source code available to you. So inside here, I've got resources, I've got movie, I've got index. And I'm just going to copy and paste this inside the movie index. And there's one other thing. Oh, that's funny. Is I need to include this thing called this pagination. This is Angular Paginate Anything. I don't know if you guys have ever seen that library. It allows you to add pagination to certain views. All of our APIs are compatible with this that library. So you can type Bower install. Save. Bower install save, and then it's Angular paginate anything. And then I just need to, inside of my app folder file, app.js, I'm going to include that as a module. App, and I'm going to include that as a module right here. And then the very last thing I need to do is override the controller. And to override the controller, because I need to provide some new variables to my index, I can go in here and essentially override any of these controllers. And what's great about Form.io is it really gives you access to everything. You get full API access. For example, let's say you want to do something special when a submission is made. You can just trigger on the form submission event and then do something. There's a lot of cool stuff you can do here, so I'm just going to delete this, and instead I'm going to copy and paste. Forgive me. In this I've got a lot more stuff going on too, so you guys can... I'm just going to copy this. And really all I'm doing is providing the URL to the index. That's what I'm doing here. Here's my here I'm passing the URL to the form, and then I'm actually filtering the movies based on the playlist. And then the state params is providing me the playlist ID, because I'm using UI router. I have that playlist ID within the state params. So hopefully, if all that went well, I didn't miss anything. I need to gulp serve. Click on that. I do need to fix that, and I'll show you how to fix that. If I click on that, I now see what looks to be like it's trying to work. What is this doing? This is... it... UI... image. Oh, what did I do there? I think I know what I did there. There is one thing that I am missing from the actual playlist. Thing. YouTube ID. It might actually be... I know what it is. Inside, this is important. Whenever you're actually using like YouTube, you also need to provide this thing called this filter called trusted, so that it will actually accept the URL. So at the very top here, I can do it there. It doesn't matter. I can do it there. Let me see if that helped. Come on. And the other thing that it might be is I named a variable different. So this is looking playlist ID. Inside here, you'll see I'm doing date, movie data YouTube ID. This probably is going to end up being that. I bet that's what I ended up doing wrong. Let's see if that was it. Ah, there it is. So make sure you get your keys right. That key you find here inside this YouTube ID, that. Just make sure you get that right. I think whenever I previously built this, I didn't capitalize the T. But that's an easy fix. So now we have this. Let's actually fix this one other problem. Oh, I need to fix that home button. That's going to be in the index.html. And whenever they click on home, I don't want them to go to home. I want them to go to playlist index. Okay. So now there's no way they can... I need to fix that. So clicking on this, I need to go to the movie index, not the. Yeah. So how you fix that is inside of the index right here. A couple of things. That grid view has a couple of events that get triggered. And right here, this is an event that gets triggered whenever that playlist is clicked on. And we can tell it to go to a different location by providing a namespace to the grid so that this row view doesn't automatically execute itself. and then telling it to go somewhere else. I'm going to copy and paste some code that I have here. Playlist, playlist there. I know we're running out of time. I apologize. Where did I do that? Oh, on this one, I actually have a grid view. I don't actually do that. So I can show you guys how to do that some other time. That's not a big deal. Let's do one last thing, which is whenever they click on the movie, I want to actually show a video. And to do that, I'm going to just modify the view of the movie. So I'm going to go up to templates, and I'm going to provide a new page called App Resources Movie View. And in here, I'm going to create a new HTML file called View. Just for now, just make sure it's getting it. Yep, it is. And then what I can then do is inside of my movie, I've got a movie view here, I can show the YouTube URL. So now this, I need to change this too. And then I also need to provide, there's this variable called YouTube that I'm adding to the view controller, which is really just the URL to the movie. So if I click on movie.js, if I go to the view, you'll see right here, and I'll explain what this is doing after I do it, after I copy and paste. You'll notice what I'm doing here. I can't just set the YouTube URL immediately, because when the page loads, I don't really quite have the movie object loaded yet. And so that's why these helpers provide this very important promise called the load submission promise. And that gets triggered, you can call it then, when that submission is fully loaded. So I could say scope movie load submission promise then. You know, we probably will just end up renaming this at some point so that it's a little bit more beautiful, but we're still version 1.0, so what do you say? And then from there, I'm actually passing in the YouTube ID to that so that whenever now I view it, I've got my movie. So now let me create some more movies here. Let me just go to darkness. And this is easy. I can just go double click the playlist ID, submit. There's the darkness showing up. There's another one. And I could host this on GitHub Pages also. That's another great thing about these apps is they're serverless. I can put this anywhere I want. So now I've essentially got a movie application. I can also, you notice in this I don't have anything. So let me add a comedy movie. Angry Birds, I guess that could be considered comedy. And now you'll see kind of where we're getting that nested resource relationship and filtering taking place, so that now comedy movies has just that one, summer movies has those, and we've essentially built an entirely working playlist managed movie management application in an hour. We did that in an hour. There's one other thing that I want to show you guys, which is the bootstrapping that I was telling you guys about. So let's say you guys want to go home and you're just so anxious to get started with this immediately, but you're lazy, like every developer. And you just want to get this up and running as fast as possible so that you can start hacking it. We actually created this utility called Bootstrap, for my own Bootstrap. And that actually allows you, let me just show you. You just have to install our CLI. And the CLI is just NPM, and let me zoom in on that real quick. Is NPM install --g, and I think it's formio-cli. So once you install that, you have access to this utility called Bootstrap. So I type formio bootstrap, and then all you do is find the GitHub page of the app that you want to bootstrap. So this is the app that we were using. This is Formio app, movie app. All I need is essentially like the GitHub path, which is Formio Formio app movie. Now, before I hit enter, I want to kind of explain what's about to happen, because I think it moves so fast, it's hard to figure out what just happened. Inside of this repo is a very special file called project.json. This project.json file is an export of the Formio project. You guys can do this yourselves. You guys can go create a Formio project. And once you're done with your Formio project, you can go to project settings and click the export project button. That's going to give you a JSON file. That's what this is. That export is linked to the app that's needed, that's linked to that API platform. So Bootstrap, what it does is it goes to this repo, looks for that JSON file, creates the project on Formio, automatically configures the config.js file, and it runs your app so that in one click, you can essentially log into your account. So the account that I'm using is just a demo account. It authenticates, it downloads the project, extracts it, creates it on Formio, and now we have an entire working application at this URL. That is being hosted right here. It just created this movie manager. And so now I can actually create, and you guys, with one single command, you guys can go and play around with this and have a full working movie management application. So I'm going to create a new playlist. And you'll see kind of what we do here. So I'm going to create a new movie. I'll just do Angry Birds just to show you kind of what we got. You've already kind of got a gist of how the app works. And so now you'll see that this also adds like little tiles to all the playlists. So anybody can go create an account on here. I could push this up to GitHub Pages. And now essentially what we've done is have a social app sharing environment. You can create an app, create your Formio project, commit that to GitHub, and as people fork it, they can type Formio Bootstrap and quite literally bootstrap an entire working application right there on their local computer. And so that's kind of where we're headed with this. We're headed towards this auto API generation, creating apps with a single click of a button, and being able to share it. So imagine having distros. Imagine having something for conferences. And if you want to start up your conference website, you type Formio Bootstrap conference and you hit enter, and it basically builds the REST API and it forks the repo on GitHub for you. And then you just commit that to GitHub Pages, and now you're hosting your entire conference off GitHub Pages in Formio. All of that is possible with this platform, and it's an entire API platform. And hopefully, this illustrates really just kind of the what you can do with it. There's a lot of amazing things that you can do with Formio. And that's it, guys.
So can we host the
thanks.
Can we host the API ourselves, or does it always have to be on Formio?
You can host it yourselves. There's a couple of ways to host it. You can either host it via Docker deployments. But if you guys are interested, I can show you how amazing it is to also use our open source API platform. So let's say I want to just run everything locally. Our open source API platform essentially allows you to host the entire API, app, everything local. And that's at that repo called Formio. I can show that to you guys if you want to see that real quick, because that's also pretty cool. Do we have time?
I feel like that matters.
Yeah, we have time.
We have time?
Yeah. As long as everyone has time.
This will just take about 5 minutes. So let's talk a little bit about open source. So this is our API platform, and this allows you to start up a new app. And let me just show you how easy this is. Let me stop that real quick, and let me go into my demo. In fact, I'm going to fork this. I'm going to fork it. You will have to have a local MongoDB running, so Mongo, and I'm just going to, what is it?
You can just type show collections.
What is it?
Show Duke?
No, it's like drop. So now, let me actually go into, so here I am, I'm inside of my Formio. Let me type npm install. It's another thing you have to do. I think this is gonna blow you away, what you're about to see. Because what we've really tried to achieve here is not only an amazing platform that you can sign up, create an account, host your apps on Form.io, do all the social sharing, but also really a system that allows you to host it yourself, to spin it up. We also have Docker deployments, so you can deploy our Docker, but check this out. So I'm gonna type node server. Everything you're about to see is local. So this is actually connecting to my local database. I forked this and I'm gonna local install. Now check this out. Which GitHub repo would you like to install? I haven't added movie yet, but right now we have that service tracker. Let's run the service tracker open source. So I'm gonna click two. It downloads the app. Now it does us something else different. So it downloads the client. Now you're probably thinking, what is the client? The client is the form builder interface, and I'll show you. So I'm gonna go Travis at form.io. This is the account that I'm gonna log into. Address and use. Not a problem. I can just rerun it and think, yeah. Node server. So now we have two things running. One is the app. The other is the open source form builder. So let's first take a look at the open source form builder. So if I go here into my browser, it's asking for the login. I just provided it via the command line. So I'm gonna say Travis at form.io. And there's my resources, there's my forms. I look at my dealer. Here's my API, it's localhost. So all of this is being done API, I can build it. Here's the open source form builder. It looks a lot worse than our hosted platform, but I think, you know, that's kind of, you know, it's open source. So that's how you would actually modify the forms and get all that. But now let's take a look at this. Here is the application being hosted on that. So if I wanted to create an admin, so let me just go create an admin here. Just to prove it, I'm going to give it a different, so I'm going to call it admin at example. And so there's my submissions. I can click on submissions and there we see. I've actually already created an admin because I needed an admin to create the project. And this is now running all local, open source. And it's liberally licensed, it's BSD licensed, which means you guys can actually use it. You can take it to work, you can extend it, you can commit. What we're trying to do is we're trying to create a community. We're trying to create a movement of this application sharing environment, these serverless applications. And the only way to really do that is to be giving in our open source offerings. And so that's what we've done. We've done that. But at the same time, we built a highly differentiated paid product. So if you don't want to spin up your own servers and manage your own servers, we would be happy to do that for you. And it's a very reasonably priced.
How many people worked on this?
Myself and two other very talented developers.
Over like a year or?
We built this, we had our first beta done in about 9 months of just developing. 9 months, highly concentrated, and then this entire platform was built in that amount of time.
There's some pretty complex examples you can show that we're doing with this.
When we're done, and yeah, if you guys, I can stay for a little bit afterwards, but sure, I can show some complex stuff. What do you guys think?
It's great, right?
Pretty impressed, yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
It's cool.
Great.
Does it work with like the video that you're doing? Does it work with the Daily Motion?
You can. Daily Motion has an embed code. and if you notice, whenever I was doing the source code, to get YouTube to work, This is YouTube's embed code. So let's say we want this to work with Daily Motion. I would have a Daily Motion ID. And you notice this says NGF. I would do, you know, whatever Daily Motion's embed code is, I would say NGF movie resource data Daily Motion. And in a matter of 1 minute, I have Daily Motion support. It's, you know, whenever things are whenever the app is serverless and you're actually modifying the app, it's easy. I used to do multimedia in Drupal. And since my eyes have been open to the serverless app development, it's just night and day. Everything is easier. The one thing that's complicated is all that REST API crap that you have to also do. And so what I set out to accomplish a year and a half ago when I started the project, I was like, you know, I really kind of like, I think felt like I was spoiled in Drupal, where I could just use a GUI and it would basically build my platform for me. And there really wasn't that in the new world. And I knew it couldn't be a CMS. You know, you see a lot of these new frameworks come out. They're trying to take a CMS and bring it to the new web. And in my opinion, the next CMS is not going to look anything like a CMS. It's going to look, I hope, it's going to look something like this. It's more data management and tools that really just make you not even have to think about APIs. You just embed forms, collect the data, view the data.
How do you implement like RPCs? Can you do that? Or is
RPC?
Like a remote procedure call? Like, you know, if you just need a call to, I don't know, do some calculation.
So in our platform, we have this concept called a webhook. And you would essentially have a webhook receiver. So inside of my movie app here, I go to like resources and I click on user. Let's say I want to do an RPC when a new user is created. I could go to actions, create a webhook, and then call a receiver. And we actually already wrote the receiver for this. It's a node library. And it's actually ridiculously easy. I'll just show it to you. For my webhook receiver. And it's just express. And so what you would do is you would, in the put here, you would implement your RPC library and end up just calling the RPC call. And it's just, it becomes a proxy essentially, mm-hmm. a proxy API. That's how you would do it. That's how I would do it.
Yeah.
This is also really good for people that want to integrate this into other systems. You know, they want their form and data management system to kind of be like an ancillary thing outside of their core, you know, system. You know, the thing that's been around for 20 years that everyone's afraid to touch. Every enterprise has that. This really allows you to kind of have this external thing and then feed stuff in as you want it, but still be able to modernize your applications. So if any of you guys work for a company that does that, we love referrals, so let us talk to them, because we'd like to implement this technology into their organization, because it's a great way to release modernized web apps on top of very legacy systems. Any other questions?
Your MongoDB made the REST API easier, right, to generate dynamically?
So MongoDB, and if you guys dig really deep into our open source library, you'll actually find a library that I wrote called Resource.js. And I would actually say this is probably like the core of the core. What this does is this uses Mongoose schemas and reflects those as REST APIs. And so I wrote this probably, I don't know, 3 years ago. And out of that, I was like, okay, that schema looks a lot like these new form definitions. I could build that schema with a form. And then I could use a form builder to build that schema, to build that API. And that's really when the light bulb went off. And I was like, I could create a form builder that builds APIs. What would that look like? And it became, as I was building it became, you know, I was realizing this could be impactful. So, and I hope it is. I mean, it's very new, and I hope it is impactful. So I appreciate the time, guys. Any other questions? All right. I think we're going to have some more deep dive questions. You guys can stick around for that. Otherwise, thanks for coming, guys. Thank you.
Thank you.